recently uploaded the 70th episode of the first, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. And of course, for the first, we were doing the last 20 of them as short lectures. So they weren't live here in the masjid. And we were taking some of those sahaba, especially from the early Muslims, from the muhajireen, who had short bios, and just making sure that we revive some of that memory. So alhamdulillah, we finished actually tonight. And inshallah ta'ala, in about 3 weeks or so, we'll start up again the full length lectures on the sahaba, inshallah ta'ala, with season two of the first. And we'll focus on sort of the Madani period now, inshallah ta'ala, starting with the early Ansar, and then some of the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, some of the instrumental figures in al-Madinah. So the first Muslims from Medina to embrace Islam and to give a hub for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and for his mission there in al-Madinah al-Munawwara. So like I said, that should be a few weeks from now, inshallah ta'ala. I'll let you all know when we get started with the bidnillahi ta'ala. Tonight, I actually want to just share a reflection once again on the dua of Nuh alayhi salam. SubhanAllah, every time I read the dua of Nuh alayhi salam, it hits me in a different way, because with Nuh alayhi salam, it is one of those surahs where you have a complaint and then a dua, and that makes up the entire composition of the surah. Literally, Surah Nuh is Nuh alayhi salam complaining about his people and the end result of that. And this was Makki Qur'an. So in Makki Qur'an, the stories of the prophets were not told in any exhaustive sense, but rather in a way that immediately related to the circumstances of the people of Mecca. So very stern warnings that you're rejecting a man who wants good for you. You're rejecting a prophet who wants good for you. And the end result of that is that the prophet will be saved, but those that rejected the prophet and mocked him will ultimately face destruction. Now, I want to focus on this question of Nuh alayhi salam making dua against the people, okay? It's very important to understand that, first of all, Nuh alayhi salam did not do this in a tantrum. This wasn't that Nuh alayhi salam ran into a particularly difficult moment in his da'wah and said, you know what, I'm done with you. This is a very deliberate dua after 950 years of trying with his people. And he mentions, you know, they mocked me in every way, they harmed me in every way. They treated me like dirt. I mean, wastaghshaw thiyabahum, as if I'm something to be cleansed from. Pushed me to the side, called me names, and I called them to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I told them that if you seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all of these things are going to happen for you in this life, as well as the hereafter. So I tried every single route with them. So the complaint is first and foremost, Ya Allah, Allahumma inni balaght, really, it's, oh Allah, I delivered the message. I really tried with these people. I really delivered the message. And then ultimately, when he makes dua against the people, it's very interesting that he gives the reasoning. You know, he doesn't want these people to even produce more wickedness on earth. Okay? That if these people are left the way that they are with the dominance that they have, then they will produce generations of wickedness. It's sort of the opposite of, or it's the other side of the coin of Zakariya alayhi salam, where he's making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَإِنِّي وَهْنَ الْعَظْمُ مِنِّي, when he says, خَفَّتُ الْمَوَالِي, خِفْتُ الْمَوَالِي, أو خَفَّتُ الْمَوَالِي, they're both authentic recitations that I realize that I don't have inheritors. فَهَبْلِي مِنْ لَدُنْكَ وَلِيَّ, there's no one to inherit the mission of prophethood, so I don't see a vehicle for righteousness that exists on this earth anymore. So, يَرِثُنِي وَيَرِثُ مِنْ آلِ يَعْقُوبُ وَجَعَلْهُ رَبِّي رَضِيَّ, to grant me a successor that will inherit my knowledge, the knowledge of the family of Ya'qub, so the knowledge of the prophets, and this will be a person that will be pleasing to you and that will ultimately spread righteousness throughout the earth. So Nuh alayhi salam is not seeing any good anymore in the people. So he's saying, Ya Allah, you know, that's it, wipe these people out. So with all that being said, I think that the question that I often get is it okay to pray against people? You know, like he prayed against his people. Did the Prophet ﷺ ever pray against people? Did he? He actually did, okay? But it wasn't his norm. It's not like the Prophet ﷺ would get bothered and that if they were really aggressive one day, then the Prophet ﷺ prayed against them. The Prophet ﷺ had enormous self-restraint sabr with his people, patience with his people. Even in Uhud, right, where you would think if these du'as came out of tantrums, right, or fits of anger, then Uhud would have been the place, because that's when they really almost killed him. And that's when he said, Allahumma ighfir li qawmi fa innahum la ya'lamun. Oh Allah, forgive my people, they don't know any better. However, we find the Prophet ﷺ prayed against Uqba ibn Abi Mu'it. He prayed against other people that died in Badr. And they were all found in one ditch, Shaj, others that were found in that one particular ditch that the Prophet ﷺ had prayed against. And I actually just spoke about the daughter of Uqba ibn Abi Mu'it, who ironically, Kulthum, radiallahu ta'ala anha, subhanAllah, the daughter of this man that humiliated the Prophet ﷺ by putting camel guts on his back, and the Prophet ﷺ's daughter, Fatima radiallahu anha, running out to him, cleaning the guts off of his back and crying. His daughter, Uqba ibn Abi Mu'it's daughter, left the house of her family and made hijrah to join the Prophet ﷺ and the Muslims in Medina. But the Prophet ﷺ made dua against Uqba ibn Abi Mu'it. He made dua against certain people. And it was accepted. They died. Okay? They were all found in one ditch. The ulama say that, how do you reconcile that then with the Prophet ﷺ saying, لَمْ أُبْعَثْ لَعَانَ I was not sent as one to curse. إِنَّمَا بُعِثْتُ رَحْمَةً I was sent as a mercy. That the Prophet ﷺ always was very specific about who he was making dua against and why. Okay? He was very specific about who he was making dua against and why. So the hikmah of the Prophet ﷺ doing so. And so for example, the ulama mention those six people or so that the Prophet ﷺ made dua against that died in the Battle of Badr, that there was a moment of triumph that they felt when they humiliated the Prophet ﷺ in front of the Kaaba. This is really towards the end of the days of Mecca. And there was a particular arrogance and boastfulness that Abu Jahl had and Uqba had and these people had, that we really conquered the Prophet ﷺ. And so the Prophet ﷺ was saying to make an example out of them the same way that they think they're making an example out of him. And subhanAllah, that's exactly what happened. That in Badr, you could count them in exactly the places that the Prophet ﷺ said that they would fall. And so Allah made an example out of them, similar to Abu Lahab, right? So there's a hikmah, there's a wisdom, even with the Prophet ﷺ's dua against the people. Now what about us? The norm should not be that we make dua against people. That shouldn't be the norm. However, you find sometimes the Sahaba made dua against their oppressors. And it was accepted. Okay? It was accepted. Sa'id ibn Zayd radiallahu ta'ala anhu was wronged by one of his neighbors, made dua against her, and she was afflicted with blindness and death. And she really wronged him. I mean, and so his response was a dua against her, was a supplication against her. And the Prophet said, Taqi da'wat al-madlum, be wary of the supplication of the oppressed, because there's no hijab, there's no barrier between that supplication and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the key function, how you interact with those texts, is be very careful from having wronged someone and they make dua against you, even if they are non-believers. If you wrong someone and they make dua against you, there is no hijab, there's no veil between that dua and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So imagine that if it's a righteous person that makes dua against you, okay? A wali of Allah who makes dua against you. Severe, severe, severe consequences of that. And you can't tell them, you know, don't do it too much, right? Just don't wrong anyone to where you would be deserving or you'd be on the other side of that dua. As for yourself, if you are wronged, you have the right to make dua against the one who wrongs you. But don't let it dominate your dua. Don't let it become your norm. Don't let it become disproportionate to the rest of your dua. And so this is sort of building off, and I'll conclude with this on the khutbah. وَتَرْجُونَ مِنَ اللَّهِ مَا لَا يَرْجُونَ You want something from Allah that they don't want. Okay? So if the only time you get emotional and into your dua is when you're making dua against the one who wronged you, then that means that what triggered you is something worldly, and you want something worldly, which is you want that punishment to manifest itself in front of your eyes in a worldly sense. That's not healthy to get attached to that idea. Because it might be that the dua that you make against the oppressor, just like other du'as, is stored for the hereafter. Allah won't let it go, but just because of its closeness to Allah does not mean that it's going to manifest in the way you want it to manifest in your lifetime. How many people made du'a against their oppressors, and they didn't see the justice of that du'a come in this life? But don't think Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't hear it. It'll come, right? So it's okay to do so, but don't let it dominate. And you know that's one of the problems when we read in some of these stories of the prophets even, that you take the unique incident and you hang on to it and you derive a methodology from it. And so it really counters the entire point and undermines the entire thrust of the prophetic message and the prophetic example, whether it's our beloved Prophet ﷺ or the prophets that came before. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept our du'as first and foremost and to make us amongst those who do not wrong others and find themselves on the other side of that du'a. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to never count us amongst the zalimeen, to never count us amongst those who are arrogant, amongst those who are rebellious, amongst those who transgress or oppress. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us for our shortcomings, forgive us for our impulses, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us amongst those that He is pleased with. Allahumma ameen. Any questions?
Mm-hmm. So the wisdom, mercy, is to do the opposite of your nafs. Your nafs is angry, you want to harm that person, but you have to control your nafs and do the opposite. We actually make dua for that.
Right. So the comment is doing mukhalafatu nafs, which is one of the things that the scholars talk about in Tazkiyah, to do the opposite of what your nafs wants you to do, what yourself wants you to do. For the most part, that is the right methodology. However, if a person is wronged and they make dua against, and they are indeed amongst the transgressed, and they ask Allah against the person that wronged them, even if they do it in a fit of anger, it will be accepted. Because they are, as long as they meet the criteria of being mazlum. And that's really the point here, is that it's not mu'min and kafir anymore. It is mazlum and zalim. That becomes the criteria of the accepted dua at that moment. And so certainly for a person though, when they're being wronged, the opposite wouldn't hold true where you want to show rahmah, so you do a dua against the person, right? But what you did mention is that if your natural impulse is anger, to do mukhalafa, to contradict the nafs is usually the healthy way forward, for sure. Jazakallah khair. Any other questions? All right. Barakallahu feekum. Subhanakallahu wa bihamdika. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.